which is a debate on motion 7192 in the name of Douglas Ross on maternity services at Dr Gray's. The debate will be concluded without any questions being put, and I'd be grateful if those members who wish to speak in the debate were to press their request to speak buttons now. And I call on Douglas Ross to open the debate.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer, and best wishes for the festive period to yourself and all the staff of Parliament as well. I'll give a very brief background on the situation with the Murray Maternity Services because it has been debated many times in this chamber before, but people will be aware that in 2018 we had a temporary downgrade for 1 year announced, which continues now as we come to the end of 2022. And I asked for this debate and I submitted the motion because just last week NHS Grampian finally produced their plan to deliver Model 6, which is a return to consultant-led maternity services. And I think it's important, as the final debate of this session and indeed the final debate of this Parliament this year, that members from across the political spectrum and the Cabinet Secretary are able to articulate their initial thoughts on Model 6, raise questions about it, and hopefully seek reassurances. I also want to say, as I always do, how much I appreciate, as a local representative, the work of Keep Mum and Maternity Voices Partnership, who have done incredible work and continue to do outstanding work raising the cases for Murray mums and families. And I also appreciate the fact that this is a cross-party issue. I know Richard Lockhead is a minister and can't fully contribute today, but he is here again. Rhoda Grant has been a great champion for this issue. My Highlands and Islands colleagues, Jamie Halcrow-Johnson, Edward Mountain and Donald Cameron as well. And I think that is welcome, that we have this cross-party consensus. I would just briefly, and I don't want to dwell on this point, however, note that when I raised this issue as MP for Murray in the House of Commons last week, and I was articulating the concerns of Murray women and families, I was told diddums by Brendan O'Hara, the MP for Argyll and Bute, and I hope and I'm sure the Cabinet Secretary will want to disassociate himself with the words of his colleague. So Model 6 was put forward by NHS Grampian at their board meeting last week, and I want to say from the outset I welcome the fact that we now have a plan to deliver Model 6. We all want to see a return to consultant-led maternity services at Dr Gray's. My worry is the timing, because the report states that it could take up to, from 2018 to the reintroduction of the service, a total of 9 years. And I'm also worried about the wording. Page 7 of the report of NHS Grampian states, consultant-led births could take place as early as the end of 2026 or early 2027. I worry the word could is doing a lot of heavy lifting in that report. Let's remember, we were told 1 year from 2018. We're now in 2022, coming into 2023, and we are told it could be the end of 2026 or into 2027. We need the pace to be far quicker than that, Deputy Presiding Officer. I will give way to Richard Lockhead.
Richard Lockhead.
Can I thank Douglas Ross very much for giving way? And the cross-party spirit of this issue is very, very important. I share the member's concern that this has taken far, far too long to get to the stage of where we are today. But, of course, we can't change the past. We have to shape the future. And I wonder if the member agrees with me that what we need now is a laser-like focus from NHS Grampian and, indeed, NHS Education Scotland, with hopefully support from the Scottish Government, on recruitment. I understand from the plan that perhaps not far short of 30 staff will be required to get full restoration of the service, including many specialists and medical staff. And therefore, the sooner we can recruit, the sooner we can bring that date forward, and that's the absolute key to progress.
Douglas Ross, I can give you that time back.
I'm grateful, Deputy Presiding Officer. I agree wholeheartedly with what Richard Lockhead has said. That laser focus must come from the Health Board, must come from NHS Grampian, must, and I hope will come from the Scottish Government all the authorities involved here. But I would also say I've got fears, because Richard Lockhead knows as well as I do that we've had campaigns to recruit people to Moray before in education, and they have been successful for a period and then they've dwindled away. When people come to Moray, they never want to leave. It's getting them there in the first place. And a concern I have with the Model 6 report is there's nothing new. We are speaking about significant numbers of staff that we need to attract there, and I'm not hearing much news from the Health Board about how they will achieve that, but hopefully that will change going forward. The other area I want to speak about is C-sections. The Health Secretary said last year, I think it was, that he wanted to see a rapid reintroduction of elective caesareans, yet the report tells us that under the Model 6 plans, it will be more than 2 years until those elective C-sections will be introduced. Why was the Health Secretary very hopefully and very enthusiastically saying we could see a rapid reintroduction of those elective caesareans over a year ago, but now we're told it will be several more years to come? The other issue that I really want to focus on is Model 6 is the ultimate destination. We want to get there very quick, but it is underpinned by NHS Grampian on Model 4. Now, let's remember, Model 4 is seeing more Moray mums giving birth in Inverness. But I think it's a red herring. I want to totally separate, as my motion says, Model 4 from Model 6. It's fundamentally flawed. It's fraught with patient safety concerns, littered with factual errors and baseless assumptions, and should be rejected. And the Health Secretary will note those are not my words, they are the words of clinicians at Raigmore Hospital, where Model 4 suggests more Moray mums should go to give birth. So why are we still on this proposal from NHS Grampian suggesting Model 6, years down the line, has to be underpinned by Model 4? The senior clinicians are advising that Model 4 should be abandoned, yet it still hangs over Model 6. And more shockingly, Deputy Presiding Officer, when this proposal was discussed by the NHS Board just a week ago, and all of the factors on Model 4 that underpin their plan for Model 6, the clinicians' concerns were mentioned not once. Not a single reference at the Health Board meeting to the concerns that are being raised by clinicians. And I think that is shocking. I think it's unacceptable by the Board. And I don't know why they're not addressing these issues. I spoke to one of the clinicians at Raigmore on Tuesday, and he told me that behind the scenes, no one is proposing anything that would make Model 4 deliverable in either the short or the medium term. Local campaigners are telling us the exact same. Keep Mum have said there is no evidence to explain how Model 4 leads to Model 6. I will give way to the Cabinet Secretary.
Cabinet Secretary.
I'm really grateful to Douglas Ross for giving way. And I just wanted to ask him, I'll come to the Model 4, Model 6 part of my own contribution. But even if there wasn't a Model 4, does he agree that for the sustainability of services, that there should be cross-boundary working for maternity services for the north of Scotland?
Of course. I do agree with that. My constituents living in Brodie are far closer to Raigmore Hospital than my constituents living in Cullen, who are closer to Aberdeen Royal Infirmary. But at the moment, that's not working. And I know, and I think Edward Mountain and Jamie Hargrave-Johnson will discuss this, there are capacity issues at the moment at Raigmore, and clinicians are raising these problems, yet it is not being addressed by NHS Grampian. I know I've taken up a bit of time, so I don't want to skirt with any issues with you, Deputy Presiding Officer, so I'll try and focus on the last couple of remarks I want to say, because my motion is clear. I want us to focus on Model 6. The clinicians are telling us to focus on Model 6, and so are the campaigners. Some of the requests I've got for the Cabinet Secretary, if that is possible. First of all, we know that there is little faith in the milestones of Model 4 and Model 6 being delivered if there's not independent oversight. So what is he looking to do to ensure there is the comfort from campaigners that we will achieve the milestones and they will be recognised independently? Because NHS Grampian have continually let down Moray, and the trust in the Health Board is at rock bottom, and nothing I've heard so far will improve that, to the extent that Keep Mum were not even involved in the development of Model 6 and the paper that went to the Board. They were asked to comment afterwards. Why were they not involved in the paper? So will he put in a project management team to ensure that these milestones are met and ensure that the project manager is from out with NHS Grampian? On staffing that Richard Lockhead raised, what conversations has the Cabinet Secretary had with NHS Education Scotland to make sure that the 2018 issue of junior doctor shortages is not repeated in the future, and the additional recruitment that's required by the report is provided. Why will it take until March next year to develop a strategy to market Moray? I said to Richard Lockhead, there has been cross-party efforts for years to recruit more people to Moray. What new is going to come up, and why does that not start immediately? There's a request for additional funding from NHS Grampian. Can the Cabinet Secretary confirm that request will be met to allow NHS Grampian to go on with their planning as quickly as possible? And the last couple of points, can the Cabinet Secretary look at the urgent re-establishment and expansion of the UHI midwifery course? Yeah. Again, this came up with clinicians. That will make a big difference to NHS Highland and also what we're trying to do at Dr. Gray's. Deputy Presiding Officer, to close, I've always said the staff and the teams at Dr. Gray's do outstanding work. I've been blessed to have one child there, and I would like to see more and more Moray mums and Moray families able to have their children there. Model 6 is the right approach, but we should have all the focus, all the attention, all the resources on delivering Model 6 as quickly as possible, so hundreds and hundreds of Moray families can see their children being born locally in the excellent facilities under the excellent care of the staff at Dr. Gray's. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Ross. In the spirit of the week and the season, happy to gift a little extra time. Karen Adam to be followed by Edward Mountain. Around 4 minutes, Ms. Adam.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And when Douglas Ross said there he was hoping to see more and more, I thought he was going to say children of his children born there, and I thought he was giving us a little insight into the future there. So I'm really pleased to be able to speak on this motion for two reasons. Firstly, because as an elected representative for Banffshire and Buchan Coast, the mums to be across my constituency clearly deserve safe and accessible maternity services. And obviously this applies to those in the western end of my constituency, which includes part of Moray. And that's why I've publicly welcomed the Scottish Government's commitment to restoring consultant-led maternity services at Dr. Gray's in Elgin. What's more, I've met with local campaign groups and the Health Board to get a better understanding of what it will take to achieve that goal. And secondly, as a mum with six children, I'm speaking from direct experience here when it comes to the importance of maternity services. I know the sense of security that they provide, and although they don't take away all the anxieties about giving birth, as any mother would appreciate, the knowledge that there's medical expertise on hand is always a comfort. But more than that, it is essential in times of emergency. And I've had experience of that, having to travel long distances from a rural location into the city of Aberdeen. And people watching may know or understand that when your waters break, if there's meconium in that, it's quite a dangerous situation, and you really do need medical assistance instantly. And I've had that experience. So I am coming from a place of empathy in that regard. If we all want decent maternity services at Dr. Gray's for the benefit of mums to be in Moray, how do we reach that goal? And we do it by being realistic about the availability of staff, we do it with properly considered planning, and we do it by taking the views of local people on board, and we do it with timescales that make sense. We don't rush in because of political expediency either. And if you go back to 2018, when the provision of maternity services changed, one of the big reasons given was because of workforce availability. And that was before I became an MSP, but it certainly rings true given my experience since I was elected last year. Time after time across Banffshire and Buchan Coast, in health and social care and other sectors, like education, like Douglas Ross had mentioned, I hear stories about problems with recruitment. In general terms, the vacancies can be there, but it's hard to attract qualified professionals to come and work in North Aberdeenshire and Moray, and it's a problem across much of rural Scotland. And it's something that's subject to ongoing work by private companies and public bodies. I don't underestimate what they try to do within their sectors, but not least within Grampian and Highland Health Boards as regards to maternity services. And I'm glad that this work is happening, and I'm certainly willing to collaborate with anyone looking to solve this problem. And I'm glad to hear that Mr. Ross brought that up in Westminster, and I would ask him if he could please push on the subject of freedom of movement for qualified professionals, and perhaps near neighbours in Europe, for example, would be appreciated. But to move on to the detail of the plan and around maternity services in Elgin, I've sought assurances around the Model 4 plans, which could deliver a networked community maternity unit as part of the journey to Model 6. And I know that the Scottish Government have asked for further work to be done before they do go ahead and approve anything. I've also asked the Scottish Government that the lived experience of women and families in Moray is central to decision-making on this issue, and I commend NHS Grampian on its development of the Model 6 plans, which it will deliver full consultant-led maternity services once again, hopefully by the end of 2026. I would, however, echo my colleague who represents Moray, Richard Lochhead, MSP, that NHS Grampian should approach this with a can-do attitude and a commitment to delivery, excuse the pun. From the top, the Cabinet Secretary for Health and Social Care has given his cast-iron commitment to these services, and we all need to be a part of that commitment. Take my time. So whether elected representatives from either side of this chamber or healthcare professionals, in conclusion, I would say that full maternity services will come back to Elgin, and this will benefit women and families in the local area, including my own part of my constituency. But they must return in a way that is person-centred, sustainable and professionally planned. Only 2 days ago, I received an email from the campaign group Keep Mum, who have been absolutely incredible, and I quote from them, "There must be a dynamic project management team in place with strict external oversight to make sure that milestones are met," and I see nothing to disagree with there. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms Adam. I now call Edward Mountain to be followed by Rhoda Grant. Around 4 minutes, Mr Mountain.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I just say at the outset, I think Douglas Ross's words are wise words. And they actually come from the heart not only of his constituents, but also the fact that he's been through this and seen firsthand what effect this is. And I have to say at the outset also that I do feel sorry for the Cabinet Secretary. It is some pity because it's not his problem. The problem is he's been left holding the baby, because it was his predecessor's problem and her predecessor's problem where this all started. So I know the Cabinet Secretary's got a lot to deal with. And I think I would also just make the point that we're all after option 6 for Moray, and it's got to be done. It's got to be done as quickly as possible. I'm going to come at this from the other way round, from the Highland perspective, if I may, and talk about option 4 and why option 4 is such a threat to the Highland service. First of all, we have to remember that Reg Moore recently had to take on all the duties of gynaecology and midwifery from Caith Ness. And that took on a huge strain. And about an extra 250 mothers a year come down from Caith Ness now to Reg Moore. I think there was only 8 births in Caith Ness last year. So not many. Most of them are coming down to Reg Moore. And Reg Moore is having to cope with that without one single extra bed. Now, I know the Cabinet Secretary's been and looked at the facilities at Reg Moore, but they're 25, 30 years old, pretty rudimentary, if I could be so bold as to say that. In fact, you know, if your baby is put into the special care unit there, you cannot even get taken down there on a bed if you've just delivered, on the basis the corridors are too narrow. In fact, nurses can't work in the special care baby unit except to deliver the care, because there's no station for making notes. There's no ability for them to work around it. So option 4 is being discussed. And what's happened, I've looked at the plans and, you know, the £5 million that were promised by the Cabinet Secretary for option 4 to deliver the extra facilities will not deliver one extra bed. Not one extra bed. But what Reg Moore is being told is that they may have to take on an extra 500 patients from Moray till option 6 is sorted out. Now, that's a real issue, because while those 500 patients are coming to Reg Moore and the facilities are being upgraded, the whole services at Reg Moore will have to relocate through the rest of the hospital. There aren't the facilities for that. I wouldn't shouldn't have to remind you, Cabinet Secretary, there's 3,200 people waiting for orthopaedic operations alone in Regmore. If you relocate the maternity unit to another unit, another ward in Regmore, it means operations will have to suffer. And that's just not good enough. And it also means that you're going to fracture the delivery of the service, because you won't be able to concentrate all the midwifery and the services that are provided there in one ward. And they don't have the facilities. They have no way of extracting, for example, the gases that are used during delivery, anaesthetic gases, which means that patients, not only or mothers delivering, will feel the benefit from it, but those staff that are working around them will also have to deal with it, and that makes it very dangerous for them in extended periods of treatment. Now, I see the clocks ticking down, but Cabinet Secretary, you went up there. You met with the clinicians, and they've told you option four is not safe. Now, if somebody tells you that, you've got to be really careful, because what I perceive is going to happen, Cabinet Secretary, is that if you push on with option four...
Through the chair, please, Mr. Mayne.
Just finishing off, presiding officer. If you push on with option four, that what will happen is mums coming down from Caithness will not be able to get in because the beds are all full and their ambulance will be just diverted to the next available hospital, which from Caithness, if you get to Highland and you've spent 2 hours trapped on a gurney to get to Regmore, the thought of spending 2.5 hours to get to Perth or 2.5 hours to get to Aberdeen is just not acceptable. So I say, as a representing the Highlands and talking specifically about Highland mums and Caithness mums in particular, what you're proposing on option four, you're told it's not safe, it's not acceptable, and whilst I always would encourage cross-border and cross-health board working, to do so when you're being told it's not safe is not something that I could ever countenance or support you in doing. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Mr. Mountain. I now call Rhoda Grant to be followed by Finlay Carson, around 4 minutes, Ms. Grant.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I want to congratulate Douglas Ross and Sukir in the debate, and indeed to Keep Mum and the other campaigners who ensure that this issue is not forgotten. And like Edward Mountain, I also want to highlight the similar plight in Caithness for the community there and hope that they will not be ignored when fighting for similar services. No one looking at the photos and film footage of the roads in the last week could be anything other than horrified at the prospect of driving in these conditions. But that is the reality for pregnant women in Moray and Caithness. Imagine having to drive those roads while driving someone in labour, trying desperately to get to a suitably equipped hospital. It should not be the case, where there are enough births to warrant suitably trained staff, that there should be that there should be support for complex labour and births. Those of my generation remember the tragic case when a midwife, paramedic and baby died when being transferred from Skye to Inverness on icy roads. It can still happen, and we can't have this happen again, especially when we have the ability to provide services much closer to people. Members of the Moray community don't have faith that NHS Grampian will implement Model 6, which reinstates full maternity services at Dr. Gray's Hospital in Elgin. And they don't believe that NHS Highland has the resources or the staff to implement the interim Model 4, where women can elect to go to Regmore Hospital in Inverness rather than Aberdeen. And as Douglas Ross pointed out, those concerns regarding Model 4 are shared by clinical staff in Regmore, and I take their intervention very seriously. Keep Mum have asked for independent oversight of the project to reinstate services to Dr. Gray's by somebody outside the Grampian NHS board, and they would prefer someone from the community who understands the issue, and I believe that would be helpful when rebuilding trust. However, it also might require oversight from someone with the authority of the Scottish Government who can act on behalf of the Cabinet Secretary. That oversight would give comfort to the community, campaigners and indeed politicians like ourselves, that the reinstatement of services was being pursued with sufficient urgency. Therefore, I ask the Scottish Government and the Cabinet Secretary if they would consider this request and address that maybe today or undertake to come back with their thoughts on how that could happen at a later date. Members of the community also believe that the basic information on which these models are based is not robust. They believe that there will be many more births moved to Aberdeen and to Inverness than is suggested. One of the reasons for originally withdrawing maternity services from Dr. Grace was staffing, and we've heard about that, the lack of junior doctors. And it's an issue in all rural hospitals and communities. And because of this, we miss out on fully trained staff, because we all know where people train, they put down their roots and they stay. If junior doctors are not placed in rural health locations, we lose them forever. This concern applies with regard to all health professionals in rural areas, and it will continue until we ensure rural areas have an adequate supply of trainees and junior staff. And I've raised this with NHS Education in Scotland, but can I ask in summing up if the Cabinet Secretary would say what steps the Scottish Government are taking to ensure this happens? The NHS Grampian Board report is full of caveats, and I share concerns that they may never reinstate full maternity services without a concerted effort. And I'm also concerned to learn that NHS Grampian do not normally invite elected representatives for Moray to their regular MSP briefings, and neither do they brief regional MSPs on progress on these issues, something I believe is absolutely unacceptable. And sadly, this gives an indication of the importance they place on the community in Moray when they do not believe they're required to brief their elected representatives, especially at a time like this. And I hope that will change, because it does not give me confidence in NHS Grampian at all.
Thank you, Ms Grant. I now call Finlay Carson to be followed by Carol Mock in around 4 minutes. Mr Carson.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer, and I pass on my good wishes for the festive season and recognise your generosity this festive time when I give my contribution. But can I say from the outset that I wholeheartedly sympathise with my colleague Douglas Ross and the problems he's facing around the serious lack of maternity services at Dr Gray's Hospital in Elgin. While my contribution isn't specifically about Dr Gray's, I believe, with your indulgence, Presiding Officer, it will highlight that this is the case not just in Moray, but in other rural areas where the Trust and Health Boards are at rock bottom. I'm sure it will be of little comfort to Douglas Ross to know that he's not alone in witnessing a serious erosion of health services in his constituency. And Galloway and West Dumfries were experiencing a similar crisis, also one that needs to be rectified as a matter of urgency. There has been much talk in this debate about option 4 or option 6, but in Galloway we have no option. Mothers-to-be in Wigtonshire are facing the daunting prospect of a 70-mile trip to Dumfries and Galloway Royal Infirmary, a journey that can often take 2 hours in order to give birth. I know from experience my wife had to stay for a period prior to giving birth in DGRI because of a condition she had meant that there was too much risk in her possibly taking an hour or more to get to hospital when labour started. But incredibly, there is a midwife-led community maternity unit in Stranraer, which was once the eighth busiest in Scotland, but bizarrely, it's currently closed. What makes this situation all the more galling is the fact that there are 4 midwives who live in the immediate area but have to travel to Dumfries instead of being employed locally in that unit. I know that there is an independently reviewed formula used to identify funding for health boards, but you honestly have to ask if it's fit for purpose when it comes to areas like Moray and Galloway. Clearly, it's unacceptable that there are glaring health inequalities when it comes to dealing with pregnant women in my constituency who are having to make this 2-hour car journey or by ambulance. I can also point out there's been numerous incidents of women giving birth in lay-bys along the A75 as recently as last month. In November, the Minister for Women's Health, Mary Todd, visited the unit at Stranraer to see for herself and the facilities on offer, but sadly, it remains closed. The Minister was also involved in discussions where one woman was tragically suffered a miscarriage but still had to make the long, long journey from Stranraer to Dumfries. And that lady bravely told of her heart-wrenching experience that was wholly exasperated by the fact that she couldn't go to her local maternity unit in Stranraer. This shouldn't be allowed to happen in this day and age. To face such untold stress and anxiety while about to give birth, this is something that should be a joyful and memorable experience, but that's been denied to so many women in Wigtonshire. Now, I know that the Cabinet Secretary has reiterated that all health services, not just maternity, should be provided as close to home as possible, which is, of course, a positive step, but I sincerely hope that we stick to that commitment and put sufficient pressure on Dumfries and Galloway Health Board to deliver on providing maternity services in Stranraer. Of course, it's not just maternity services that are being affected, but other health services previously delivered at the likes of our cottage hospitals, which have been largely paused since the outbreak of the pandemic. And again, Dumfries and Galloway Health Board have refused to instigate a full return of these health services previously provided in Castle Douglas, Kirkcudbright, Newton Stewart and in Moffat, even though that's not in my constituency. And there's been enormous strength of local feeling about the importance of delivering a range of health services such as palliative care and step-down care in our cottage hospitals. So it's abundantly clear that people need to be cared for as close as possible rather than having to undertake journeys that are unreasonable. In conclusion, Deputy Presiding Officer, it's important that the Scottish Government and indeed health boards listen to the people that matter, the public, and that means everywhere, in rural and urban areas. They deserve and demand maternity and other health services on the doorsteps where they live.
Thank you very much, Mr Carson. I think you may have tested to destruction the definition of relevance, but at least you didn't dress it up as a point of order. So. Thank goodness for small mercies. Final speaker in the open debate, Carol Moore.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. And members will be pleased that some of my contributions have been made, so I will be quite brief. But I wanted to thank Douglas Ross for bringing the debate to the Chamber. One of the first speeches I made in Parliament in June 2021 was a motion brought by Douglas Ross calling for an action to deliver locally based maternity services for women in Moray. And it is a concern, Deputy Presiding Officer. I think we can all agree that we are here again some 18 months later debating the same topic. Part of my contribution was going to be to speak a bit about what Finlay Carson had been saying in my own South of Scotland region. I know women who are having to travel from Stranraer right across to Dumfries, and it is wholly unacceptable. If you've ever been on that road, you would absolutely accept that point. So I hope the Cabinet Secretary does have something to say on that. Just to say a few words to close up, I think people will know that I have brought to the Chamber many times the issue of the Women's Champion. It is yet another example of, unfortunately, the Scottish Government falling short in terms of marks of women's health. It is clear that a Women's Health Champion is needed to spearhead many women's health-related campaigns and issues, but I think this gives us a clear indication that we have to get this in place. And people will know that I have been asking since June when we could get an appointment made for a Women's Champion, and I say to the Minister, please can this be one of the first appointments made in 2023, because we need someone who can push these issues and scrutinise these issues and go back to the government and also report for us so that we have this information in Parliament. It would benefit the women in Moray, the discussion of this member's debate in my own constituency, but I am sure there will be other examples. So it is really, really important that we get this done. Can I just say in concluding that I pay tribute to the campaigners who have consistently stood up for the services that they want to have, and it is our responsibility to keep bringing this to the Chamber and to push the Government harder and harder on this issue, and I will not stop asking for the Women's Champion to be put in place, because I fully believe that it will help us address some of these issues. Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer.
Thank you very much, Ms Mochan. And I invite Hamza Youssef to respond to the debate, Cabinet Secretary, around about 7 minutes.
Thank you very much, Deputy Presiding Officer. Can I also begin, as you did and many others did, in wishing everybody all the very best for the festive season, a very Merry Christmas indeed, and all the best for 2023. I have a secret list of who I think will be getting a lump of coal on Christmas, but it would be uncharitable for me to even suggest who might be on such a list. But let me begin this debate, as is customary, for thanking Douglas Ross for securing during this important members' debate. I'm pleased that, notwithstanding the exceptionally long nights we've had over the last couple of nights engaging in the GRR bill, that we were still able to make time in the business bulletin for this important debate, because it is important not just to the members in this chamber, but we know very many people right across Murray, but as Finlay Carson's demonstrated, actually right across Scotland as well. I am pleased to also acknowledge that there's an exceptionally good cross-party campaign in this regard, and I've met with a number of elected members, of course with Douglas Ross, with Richard Lockhead, Rhoda Grant, and many others right across the various different levels of the political spectrum and across political parties on what I think is an excellent campaign. Let me also, in my very opening, restate the government's absolutely cast iron commitment, as Karen Adam asked me to do so, that cast iron commitment to returning consultant-led maternity services at Dr. Gray's. I won't go through the background because I think people are very aware of it and have heard of the background from other members. I'll try to address some of the points that have been raised. And let me come to a point that has been made by a number of colleagues across the chamber. And Edward Mountain made this point, I think, most forcefully in his contribution. It is so important that we do listen to clinicians, whether it's in Rigmore, whether it's clinicians and Dr. Gray's themselves. And that clinical expertise is exceptionally, exceptionally important. I don't want anybody to leave this chamber thinking that I don't listen and put a lot of stock and weight on the opinion and expertise of clinicians. That's why when I stood here last talking about Dr. Gray's in this chamber, I wasn't in a position to be able to approve the Model 4 plans because, frankly, the concerns raised by clinicians to me were playing heavily on my mind. I want to reflect for a moment also on what I think, the question that Douglas Ross really has posed and others have posed to me in relation to Model 4 and the concerns that have been raised by them as elected members, by Keep Mum, by MVP, by others as well. And I think Model 4, forgive me, has probably become a distraction. What we're trying to do is describe an improvement journey with all the elements required for effectively that integrated model. When I asked Douglas Ross, you know, do you believe in that cross-boundary working, his answer was absolutely. And I think that's right, because if we're going to have a sustainable model, with all the recruitment challenges we know that we have, not just in the northeast of Scotland, I suspect in many areas of remote, rural and island Scotland, then that cross-boundary working, I think, is going to be exceptionally important. But it's fair to say that there's concerns around Model 4, clinical concerns, community concerns, elected representative concerns around Model 4. I have to say, in terms of Model 6, the plan that we have in front of us, I know it will not go fast enough for many people, but I would say it's far more ambitious than, for example, when I was standing in this chamber many months ago and people were saying that it might take 10 years or 7 years, or that's what they had heard from others. So we have a more ambitious Model 6 plan. I think with all these things taken into account, I've decided that we will not continue with Model 4 as previously outlined. However, I do expect, as I've already said, I expect NHS Highland and Grampian to continue to work together to ensure the sustainable maternity services for women in the north of Scotland. Of course, I'll give away here.
Douglas Ross.
I'm grateful to the Cabinet Secretary for giving way, and that is a very welcome announcement. It's what I asked for in this motion. It's what campaigners have been asking for. But he's saying that he will not continue with Model 4 in its current form. We can't just have a change of name. I'm just trying to tease this out. The concerns will remain if it's called something different, if it's just slightly tweaked. So what does he mean by we won't be continuing with Model 4 in its current form? And on his point about me agreeing with the cross-border opportunities, we know with Model 6 there will still be a need for some mums in some circumstances to go to Aberdeen. We all accept that, but they should be the exception rather than the rule. And I want to see as many as possible of the 1,000 births average in Murray each year happening at Dr. Gray's.
Cabinet Secretary.
I suspect I'm not going to be able to do this issue the justice in the time that we have, so I'm happy to, as always, pick up with Douglas Ross and other members, maybe even do a briefing for cross-party members to address some of these issues. So what I mean is that our laser-like focus should absolutely be on Model 6, the end destination, that full return, that restoration of consultant-led maternity services to Dr. Gray. So we won't be proceeding with Model 4 as per Rafe Roberts' report. What I would say is really important, though, is that it is really, for me, vital that where there are recruitment challenges, there may be cross-boundary working in relation to ensuring that this service is sustainable in Dr. Gray's. What I also mean, for example, you know that in the plan that... Douglas Ross knows that in the plan that has been put forward in relation to Model 6 by NHS Grampian, they make the point, and endorsed, of course, by NHS Highland, that we are going to put significant investment into Rigmore because of all the reasons that have been articulated by Edward Mountain already. It's in need of refurbishment and so on and so forth. And not just refurbishment, I think there's a need to invest absolutely in the workforce in Rigmore too. So if there is a time period, as per the plan at the moment, where Rigmore has the capacity, clinical, has the infrastructure in place to take more women from Elgin or from Moray more widely, while Dr. Gray's is still being fully restored, because there's a gap, there's a time gap between 2025 and the end of 2020, I will shortly, the end of 26, 27, should women have the choice to go to Rigmore, which is a shorter journey for many of Douglas Ross' constituents, as opposed to go to Aberdeen? I think that's a conversation that's absolutely worth having. So make no mistake about it. My focus and the focus that I've said now to the Health Board is that, given the ambitious timescales, in my view, around the return of maternity services to Dr. Gray's, that the focus must be on Model 6. Yes. Please.
Richard Lockhead.
Can I thank the Cabinet Secretary for giving way and welcome his announcement, which is something I was calling for in conveying the views of Keep Mum at a recent meeting a few weeks ago as well. In terms of the integrated model, I think there's no one in Moray who would dispute or argue against the idea of staff being recruited on a cross-border basis, because everyone's outcome-focused about the fully restored service at Dr. Gray's. So that integrated model, I think, is perfectly acceptable in terms of the views of staff recruitment. If consultants work between Rigmore and Dr. Gray's, that will be welcomed if that plugs the gap in terms of the restored service. But in terms of the timescales and recruiting consultants, one of the anxieties in Moray is affordability. And the plan from NHS Grampian for the full restoration asks for or suggests that what's required is just under £22 million of investment between now and the next 5 years, with £7 million a year thereafter. So is there any comments the Cabinet Secretary could make about the anxiety locally about affordability, which would slow down the timescale if that was to be reality?
Cabinet Secretary.
Yeah, I can give assurance to that. But before I do that, can I just say that Richard Lockhead really articulated it perfectly, that what we're talking about is that integrated model. So let me be clear, we're not going to proceed with Model 4. Model 6 is now the focus. And instead of even calling it Model 4, Model 6, let's just say that it's the restoration of consultant-led maternity services at Dr. Gray's. That's where we're going to go. But the importance of the integrated model, I think Richard Lockhead has articulated exceptionally well. If it helps with the sustainability of the service, which I think it absolutely will. The short answer to your question is yes. I have committed, the government has committed, to the full restoration of consultant-led maternity services at Dr. Gray's. That then, of course, that means that we have to step up and ensure that it's fully funded as well. So we'll do that, and we'll always be an element of discussion, as you'd imagine, with the Health Board in that regard. And I should say, none of this means that we're not going to continue our investment in Rigmore. I want to give that absolute assurance. Edward Mountain has raised it with me, but Fergus Ewing has raised that issue with me. Many MSPs have raised the issue of investment in Rigmore with me. I suspect vastly out of time. I don't know if there is some additional time, presiding officer.
I'm being generous, Cabinet Secretary.
Oh, good. Okay. Well, I'll try not to keep people back.
Continue for the time being.
Too much, because there was a number of questions that were. Sorry, how much time?
I can give you another couple of minutes.
Okay, another couple of minutes. That'd be great, Presiding Officer. Much appreciated. Because I wanted to touch upon the issue of a number of issues that were raised with me direct, and I maybe be better writing to some members because of the time constraints. So in relation to the question that was asked to me about external assurance, it was raised by a number of members and perhaps a perception of distrust in relation to the Health Board. What I would say is that two things. First of all, there is an external assurance panel in place. People, members have met, I think, with Linda De Castiger, who's heading that, but she's not the only person who's part of that panel. As the name suggests, there are a number of people who are involved in that external assurance. I'm not minded to put an external project manager into Grampian. I think Grampian do have to own this. They have to have ownership of it. And I sincerely believe in the discussions that I've had with them that they've got an absolute commitment. And I think their plan, which is again, far shorter in terms of timescale than some members had expected when they'd raised 10 years, 7 years with me previously, shows that they are committed to this. In terms of the issue around C-sections, again, I'm always clear to say that I'm going to be always going to take clinical advice in this respect. So why did we come up with a different timescale previously? Because that was the timescale that was in the Rafe Roberts report that was presented to me. When that report was rightly interrogated by clinicians, then they have come with a timescale of early 2025 for elective sections being reinstated to Dr. Gray's. In terms of NES, that's been raised by a number of colleagues, both in terms of Grampian but also NHS Highland. And I think a broader issue, maybe even touching upon what Finlay Carson has said, a really important issue about training and getting more trainees to train in rural Scotland. NES are fully involved in that very mission. In fact, they've been left in no doubt in relation to Dr. Gray's. My expectation of their involvement, and again, I'll probably write to the members, given that I only have a little bit of time left. I thought Karen Adams made an excellent point about the freedom of movement and immigration. I should say, having raised this issue with the UK government previously, that certainly from the health perspective of the fellow health secretary, they certainly understand the need for the Home Office for immigration to work to help us to plug some of the gaps in the workforce. It's not the panacea, but certainly could help. And I'll conclude by perhaps addressing the point made by Carol Mockin in relation to the Women's Health Champion. We will update Parliament, either myself or Marie Todd, will update Parliament early in the new year. Carol Mockin is absolutely right. She has every right to push the government really hard on this appointment, and we made a commitment in that respect. But it's so important that we get the right person, because that person, I hope, will stay in post for many, many years to come, push the government in relation to the Women's Health Plan. But I'm absolutely committed, and I'll end, Presiding Officer, thank you for your generosity. I'll end by saying that the government is absolutely committed to fully restoring and returning consultant-led maternity services to Dr. Gray. We'll not proceed with Model 4. We will proceed to that end destination. And, of course, I look forward to keeping members updated. And again, I finish where I started by wishing you all the very best for the festive season.
Thank you very much, Cabinet Secretary. Can I congratulate everybody on persevering, making it through to the end of what has been a long week and a busy session. Can I add my good wishes for the Christmas season and for the new year? And with that, I close this meeting of Parliament.